and welcome from myself, Jamie of Geosynths, and we're back with Synth Show episode 177. Hope you're all doing very well on this Sunday morning, evening, afternoon, wherever the hell you are in the world. I'll go and say hello to a few people in the chat. Who have we got? I mean, Kent is in. Kent started off rather early morning. Hello to you, Kent. Good to see you. Who else have we got? We've got Grace. Hello, Grace. Good to see you as well. Homegrown, Paul Holmes, Tim Grogan. Tim's been very, very busy. He's done his own electronic kind of night over in Nashville. You know, electronic music with modular and that. And then just the other day, he was at the Grand Old Opry as well doing his drumming, because he's actually a drummer. So, very diverse. Good to see you. We got Zoe likes tea. Good evening, everybody. Hello to you. And a whole host of other people. Well, I hope you're all okay. And I'm going to introduce you all to the team. And there they are. We're starting next to me is Andy Vonal. That's his artist name. We've got James Glew down there. We've got...
Nope.
Hello to you. We've got Dave there. How you doing, Dave?
Very good, thank you.
And we've got Paul as well. How you doing, Paul?
I'm fine, thank you.
Excellent stuff. And this all kind of come together because we actually did Paul's do, all of us, the other, what was it? It was a week ago, wasn't it? God, time's flowing, yeah. Hasn't it? a week ago. So we all went there. It was kind of like the EMOM crowd. And you can see a little bit from the photo from the thumbnail of this stream. There was ourselves and a number of others, but yeah, Paul, do you want to maybe take it away and let us all know what that night was all about?
It was actually my 61st birthday on the 11th, which was the day, it was the weekend it snowed, so we had to cancel it and put it back 2 weeks, but originally it should have happened for my 60th. Now, fortunately, it didn't happen for me 60th, because at that point, I didn't actually know any of you. Because I only started going to the EMOMs after I had the brain tumour diagnosis. Mm. Just basically to take my mind off things, because we didn't know what was going to happen until I had the second set of tests in November. And I got the... I'm not out of the woods, but they're not going to kill me anytime soon, so it's happy days, as it were. Yeah. So we,
well, that was the thing
first.
You mentioned earlier, you know, that back then you didn't know EMOMs or anything like that. I didn't. None of us did, I don't think so, about a year or so ago. But, of course, that's where I sort of met you first, was down at Jim's EMOM, down in Derby.
That's right, yeah.
So you were going to them. And, of course, now you've been able to get, feel a lot stronger now to go out and do your own. And you've done a load of EMOMs now, haven't you?
Yep. I've done about 8, I think, so far.
Yeah.
Including yours at Blackpool, Sowerby Bridge,
yeah.
Derby. I think I've done Derby now about 3 or 4 times, Sheffield.
Right.
And I've got several more booked already for next couple of months, sort of thing. But I'm cutting down to just doing a couple of months, because what I'm finding is I haven't got time to prep properly, write new music, because basically after I started coming to the EMOMs, I looked at what I'd already got recorded and I scrapped everything. about 5 or 6 years of work, and I just scrapped it, just deleted it all. I wasn't happy, so I started working and I changed all my gear, so that you've seen sort of stuff I bring along to the EMOMs. It's really compact. Because I couldn't lug great synthesizers. And I mean, at one point, we'd a ridiculous number of keyboards. I think between me and Edward, we'd got something like 13 MIDI controllers alone.
Jeez.
And about 10 synthesizers. And then we'd got soft synths, and we'd got 3 computers on go with soft synths on. And I've replaced most of that with an iPad.
Yeah, that's the thing, isn't it? You do see that at some of the EMOMs. I mean, I'm like an idiot lugging around keyboards anyway, but you will see someone with an iPad. And it reminds me of the days when I used to gig and, you know, I've turned up with the keyboards and PA and lighting and all that kind of thing. And then the comedian would turn up and he wouldn't have anything. He'd just use my mic. Oh, used to infuriate me. That. But yeah, you'll see someone with just an iPad and you think, oh, and it sounds so great as well. But yeah, yep. I mean, what we will do is play a little bit actually of you. You had, there was yourself and your son. And yep. The other fella's name, I can't remember the other fella, but he was absolutely brilliant. Martin, he was brilliant on that guitar. Yeah. Beautiful sound. But we'll check it. It is a bit of filming from Dave doing a bit of his 360 stuff. The shot. There we go. And then Edward was on at the end with you, wasn't he? There he is. So
yep.
Let's. So, that was your birthday bash, and you've been doing lots of EMOMs and plenty more booked in. You're doing Sheffield, aren't you, this week?
This Friday, yeah. When we did that, a lot of it was improvised because we'd only had just over 2 hours to rehearse.
Mm.
And me and Martin hadn't played together for 25 years.
Wow.
I played with him in a band 25 years ago, and we did some support slots to bands like the Enid, Fish, the Flower Kings, who, funnily enough, are playing in Sheffield in about 2 or 3 weeks' time. They're supporting the Osric Tentacles.
All right, okay, yeah.
They're a progressive rock act from Sweden. And they must be, well, if I'm 61, they must be heading towards their 80s, I would have thought.
Oh, wow. Because they were
considerably older than us 25 years ago. So I would have thought they were at least 15, maybe 20 years older than us. Mm. So they've got to be knocking on a bit, like, but they're still out there, still playing, and apparently they're still popular. So,
well, that's the thing, isn't it? It's keeping everybody going. You mentioned there earlier about improvisation. The king of improvisation is Mr. Andy Brooks. He, not saying that the other two aren't, but Andy makes everything with his modular from kind of scratch and builds up patterns and everything. And I've got a bit of Andy when he was at Sheffield. Well, you do more so than I do. I just tried to hit the right chords, which I didn't do what Paul's do. So here's a bit of Andy at Hagler's Corner.
So we'll see how that goes, shall we? You plugged in? Yeah?
I think so. Can I just do...
Thank you. So there's a bit of Andy doing his thing. Unfortunately, Andy's not feeling too well. He's got a bit of the sniffles and everything, so he may struggle a little bit. But apart from that, how are you and how are things musically with you, Andy?
Yes.
Right, okay.
It's been, like I said, it was a lot of fun, actually, last week doing Paul's too. And seeing sort of the gang meeting up and meeting other folk there and just chatting with people. It was really, really lovely, lovely atmosphere. So, Paul, thanks for asking us to be part of that. That was a real pleasure.
You're welcome, mate.
Musically, not done an awful lot since, because it's been a week, been at work. And there's this coming week, though, I think there's Sheffield EMOM on Thursday. No, it's Friday. It's Friday. And it's a big event, isn't it, Jim? Because you're playing at 4 in the morning. I won't be there.
Not 4. But, no, not going at 11 or 12.
But. Yeah, so I'll be there for that. I've got a reserve slot. I'm not down to actually properly play. So it may well be that I won't be playing. But it would be quite nice just to go along as a punter, mill out. Yeah. I got a notification from you, Dave, didn't I? Well, you sent it me through about there's a new EMOM starting in Doncaster. I've got myself a slot on that. That's in May. That's coming up. So that'd be nice. I mean, we are really well served for them round in this part of the world.
Very, very, yeah, very lucky. Definitely.
Spoiled.
The thing is there as well, I mean, like Sheffield, you're not too far then really to travel down to Derby. There it is. It's so weird that there's nothing apart from what I was trying to do over here in Blackpool, and you know, it's on pause at the moment. So, but yeah, other than that, there's nothing this way. Very strange. But anyway, it's all good. You mentioned there about Jim. Jim's going to be doing the Sheffield one. Also runs his own email down in Derby. But you're sort of one of the headliners. Is it going to be a longer set that you're actually doing then, Jim?
Yeah, so there's three of us doing an hour each. So there's myself, Brawny, who runs the Sheffield EMOM, and Die Dan Die.
He's brilliant, Die Stafford, Dan Die.
Yeah. So it's going to be quite a sort of dancey affair, I think.
That's exactly what it needs. I mean, that's sometimes with EMOMs, you find that, you know, that it starts to build up over the course of the night, and then someone will go on where it'll just be like an ambient of just one note held for 15 minutes, you know, and it kind of, it's interesting, but it kind of killed, you see people going, turning away, you know what I mean? So, we'll play a little bit of a set you've just dropped, actually, for Clownfest, and we'll just play a little bit of this. We'll be right back. Well, there's a bit of James Glew, the Electron King. I mean, your stuff always sounds great in person. It's like being slapped around the face sonically, you know, when you get these sounds, especially your distorted ones coming through. And of course, you've been dropping in now the subsequent 37 as well. That's you're sort of just growing and growing and growing. There's going to be like vans turning up with glue on the back, like, yeah, you know, because that's all your kit. Yeah,
Glue crew.
The Glue crew. Oh, there it is.
Glue crew. Yeah.
Yes. So you've got that big longer set sort of going on, and everything seems to be sort of going up and up and up for you, really. Is there much more sort of planned for you during the summer months coming up?
Well, one thing that's not going up is my bank balance. But
there is that. But there's time for that, isn't there? There's time for that. You know, it's I don't know. Once EMOM is a little bit more under the spotlight, you know, I'm sure that will change. Indeed, you know, if it comes from Sonic State's way or whatever.
Definitely. So yeah, I mean, obviously I've got this Sheffield gig on Good Friday, and then. Next month, got a couple. A gig at the Hairy Dog in Derby, and then playing this Locktronica festival, which I have a poster for here, which Mark Radcliffe's Oon are playing as well.
That's a nice poster. That's really good, though.
Doesn't it?
Cool.
A few others, Flaves, you know, a few E-Mommers on there. So yeah, that's what it works with. It's like really, it's like a micro festival, but it should be a really good atmosphere. And then what else? I'm sure there's other stuff coming up in June. Then I'm playing Off the Tracks Festival again, 2nd of September. A couple more EMOM people are going to be playing that as well, I think.
Good stuff,
It's all happening.
Well, we'll all go back to I'm going to go to Dave now, but we'll talk a little bit more about, because I'm interested in how everybody's music has evolved since they've started doing EMOMs to where you are kind of now, if it has, and what sort of change. But last but not least is the fantastic Dave. Where is he? There he is. And he's you get around a lot doing these, don't you, mate? You travel a lot. In fact, I see on your feed, you're always at some kind of event somewhere, and your pictures off your phone always look absolutely amazing. I don't know what it is. You've got this touch. I don't know what it is, and your photos always look fantastic. But you were at the bash the other day. Artist name MHO. And we'll play just a little bit of Dave with his machine, how he sort of performs with machine, changing and manipulating effects and levels and so on like that. So here we go. Again, you know, your stuff always sounds fantastic, you know, really high quality and very sort of anthemic, is that a word? I don't know. And, you know, it just, everything just sits, there's lots going on, but it's very melodic, you know, it's just amazing how you sort of do it, because it's very easy, isn't it, for electronic music. I know when I do it, to make it a bit too, you know, repetitive and but you've got these nice jolly, there's a jolliness to your music, Dave. I think that's what I'm trying to say. So how did you think the gig went at Paul's Bash?
I had an absolutely wonderful day. Thank you, Paul, for inviting me along and the others. It was just great. It's an honour to be there. You know, I saw you first at the Blackpool EMOM, and we just chatted about the Transcendent 2000 and reminisced with a couple of old farts that we are. and we joked at the time that we're on tour now. You know, since Synthfest, I've covered 6,000 miles.
Wow.
Almost entirely on EMOMs. So that's a grand's worth of petrol that I've spent on that.
That's a lot. There is a hidden expense to all this, I know, buying a PA and all that. Like an idiot, but that's just me. That's just me. But
other hidden expenses are like, I'm trying to speed up my setup, and I watch Jim and Andy with some envy, where they just open a case, all these wires just pop out. They play, and then they just shut it all up, and then I have time to chat away with people. Whereas I set up off stage, carry my table on, put it on there, do my thing, walk it off, and then I'm fine. Then I got to spend ages packing it all up together in the little bags and what have you. So a hidden expense, I've bought a flight case to put it all in, so I can do the jack in the box trick. I might have a mess to have to deal with back at home, but at least I can
always
quickly
do.
Close and go.
You when you go there, everything's all...
A telly stand with you and a whole load of your own screens.
I got that idea from Dots.
Dancing pixies and...
The projector problem is, if you try to set up a projector, you've got to get it a certain distance away in order for it to show. Setting up a screen is a pain, as you saw from the Bradford one. I think another system set up a projector, put it against the wall, but it was a bright yellow wall. You could hardly see his graphics. So I thought, I'll get a telly. I saw Dots playing with a telly. Saw this one from one of these cash exchanges for like 60 quid, and I thought, that's not too bad. Because if I break it, it's 60 quid as opposed to 600 quid. So the only problem is the stand costs me more, because you have to have a more substantial stand. And of course, Dots, there's two of them. I have to carry all this stuff myself. It's a bit of a challenge.
Right.
The other downside I discovered at Paul's is that it's introduced some USB line noise into certain systems.
Yeah, I noticed a little bit of that. And I found that.
Remember at Dots, tried to plug their video into your projector at Blackpool EMOM, and they got horrific mainstream issues. I've just been spending some time looking for earth isolators and got these little adapters that will isolate the USB side of it, because there's no isolating HDMI earth unless I unplug the earth from the monitor, and I'm thinking that's probably not a good idea. And I've also followed Paul's advice and got myself one of these.
I use one of them. They're all right then. Yep. They're not bad. It's just
so you
can recall it. It's just so you can recall it on your phone and all that sort of stuff. It's nice and handy. Nice and handy, definitely. So not enough input though for Andy.
There's a nice thing about the EMOMs is that all these people we're all basically trying to solve the same problem: how to present our tunes. The variety of solutions that people come up with are just amazing. And shamelessly steal other people's ideas, and other people see my stuff and go, oh, how did you do that? For example, the visuals, I use a software called Magic Music Videos for the ones that react to the audio. Another plugin when I have a more static video to play back that's synced specifically with the tune that I'm playing. So I'm adding tremendously to my workload. Might have bitten off more than I can chew, but it's all good fun, you know.
It is. No, definitely. All of you, have a bit of a think about, you know, what I asked sort of earlier about how things have changed for you over the time. Have you approached writing music differently? And I'll, we'll go around the sort of table, but I just want to first plug a little bit of my stuff, obviously, because I do sound design, though with all this AI stuff, which we'll be talking about later, I don't know how long I'll be doing that. You can go Paradox Volume 1 is the last one I did for the Trigon, which doesn't seem to be a bit of... I think it's the synth people are interested in, but I think the price has just put people off so much. Where is it? I'll play something, if it will play. Sometimes it doesn't play from my website for some reason, so just... play the title sound. Which is a lovely sound. And then, in case you didn't see, I dropped a video, a review of the Implexus, I had the guys on 2020. I did an interview with them, and they were doing a Kickstarter, and they had about 10 days left, and they weren't quite at the... They were about, I don't know, 10 grand away or something from it. So I had them on, did a little video edit, and then after 10 days, they got it. Not saying it was all down to me, because it wasn't, but, they got through, got the Kickstarter. But, of course, as we know, the whole thing about locking down and then the prices of components and being able to get hold of them sort of hit. So everything's kind of been on a bit of a pause. But he asked me probably November, if I'd do a review. I said, yeah, and then it sort of turned up a couple of weeks ago. So I did the review, and of course, how I've done it before with things with monosynths, because I don't do sounds for monosynths, even though I've got them that can store patches, I don't sort of do that in terms of geosynths, but I've reviewed things like the Behringer Cat, the Pro One, the Monopoly, and some others, and I've always built a track from scratch from it. So I did the same with this, and it's at the start of the review. And everything you hear with this is just the Implexus, nothing else. The drums, everything. Made the drum sounds individually and sampled into machine, and then tracked the individual sounds. So... And then I did the review, so you can go and check it out. And the thing about the synth is that it's the kind of combination of West Coast versus East Coast, and which isn't really that new for us now in desktop units. We're seeing it. But at the time that they brought this out originally, no one else was doing it. You see things in Eurorack land and obviously Buchler, but the whole thing is that you use these complex... oscillators and build your sounds up that way and utilize envelopes and LFOs to create your tone and changes over time, like you do with FM and linear FM, and not use a filter. But they added a filter. It's a nice, lovely 12 dB filter, actually. And the combination of the two just sound absolutely great. I was really impressed with it. So I'll play a little bit of that if I can. Oh. And as mentioned, it's a 12 dB filter, but you get low pass. Yeah, I just said that, Jamie. Cheers. Anyway, you can check that out on my channel. So I dropped that, which was really, really good. So, yeah, guys, EMOMs. What I found is, originally, I was doing some tracks that I'd already done, and then I was stemming them out and try and recreate them on the MPC. And I was just finding it so frustrating. So a couple of them... like the slow one that I do at the beginning, and then the sort of jazzy house thing, they're all just done on the MPC. But they're two different approaches. I personally, I prefer to do everything in Logic and then spit it out and then do some little bits over the top. But I found, and I'm having to work two different sort of ways. But what about yourself? I mean, Andy, I'm going to leave you, Andy, to the last, because you're very hands-on with your stuff. So I'm going to go with you, Jim. Jim, do you approach, and how has that changed?
So before sort of doing the whole live thing, I was struggling with the whole concept of how to sort of take stuff I've done in the studio and actually sort of perform it. And what I've ended up doing is just completely parking anything I was doing in the studio and just do it all with a fresh sort of viewpoint and fresh equipment. And not only do I find that easier when it comes to actually performance, I actually find it much easier to write this way away from the computer. So I'm just writing on the electron boxes, and it's, for me, it's just so instant that, you know, I can get something together in, you know, just a matter of minutes, and I've got the real basis of something. And so, you know, it's just become, there's like no disconnect between my ideas and actually getting the sounds out of the equipment now. Whereas with the door, that, you know, you've got all the option paralysis and stuff like that. And with the electron stuff, I just have so many happy accidents all the time that I'm like, oh my God, that's brilliant. And, you know, just stuff will, I'll make mistakes and it'll be a brilliant mistake. And I'll be like, I need to do that more. And
sadly for me, with the MPC, I just have accidents. I understand that, though, because you're staying in creative mode, aren't you? With that, and it's immediate. Whereas with the door, it is stop, start, stop, start, stop, start.
It takes you out of flow, you know, whereas I can sort of get into and remain in the flow state really easily with the setup that I've got.
And so, you know, has your music, though, the style of it changed over the time?
Yeah, completely. It's a lot more positive sounding on the whole as well. It's a lot sort of happier, and it's more sort of focused towards, you know, sort of performing and presenting it to an audience, and with the idea of getting them to feel something positive from what I've
Well,
what
I'm really glad that Doom, Gloom and Armageddon is positive, Jim, because sometimes it... Sometimes it's so full on. Sorry, that came across negative, and I didn't mean it that way.
Oh, you cynic, Andy.
So, Dave, I mean, you do everything with machine anyway. So, you know, I suppose maybe that sort of process hasn't kind of changed for you. Though you are performing with sort of machine, but of course you've gone around and you've done 6,000 miles and you've done a number of these. Has your, because I noticed there are quite a lot of style changes in yours, from your slower stuff to your more, you know, up-to-date, up-tempo kind of things. So, but you tell me, what has changed for you, if anything?
Well, it's a constant learning process. So full disclosure, I create the tunes originally in Ableton Live. Sometimes I've done them in machine, but mostly they're in Ableton Live. I print the stems out. I then arrange them in machine, sometimes chopping them. So then I can manipulate the sounds, mostly by adding effects and reverbs and what have you. And some of the pieces I actually do stutter edits and what have you whilst I'm playing them. Most times, however, this is the first time I've ever heard my stuff outside of headphones. So I'm hearing, is the kick kicking, you know? Yeah. So, because behind the speakers, you can't really deal much with the top end. So I've got the EQs on the outputs, and you'll see me listening for the resonance, well, the kick frequency around anything between 58 hertz and 120 to try get that sweet spot, so that it's really, and it's different for every venue.
That explains why my sub was peaking all the time.
Yes, apologies, but I just love that bass. I just am addicted. So, the learning processes are, how do I get from one track to the next one? So I've introduced a little bit of an iPad noisy little twinkling in the background, which I fade in as the track ends. It's then filling the sound and then fading it in, fading it out when the next track starts. But it's interesting how to get from one track to another when essentially I have to load the next project, which is pretty quick, but it still leaves a bit of an awkward silence. Sometimes it's nice.
Yeah, you feel like you're under the microscope a little bit. I mean, yes. Jim doesn't have that problem because it's just seamless from one track to another. So so sometimes you do feel like, you know, you're a little bit unsure, you know, when to clap kind of thing. But,
clap at the end.
So, again, I took to EMOM. It was a project I was going to embark on, and then I lost my good lady wife about a year and a half ago to cancer. And this, as you can imagine, put a bit of a writer's block. I wasn't able to concentrate and get to my happy place. But I thought, I'll go ahead with this project anyway. And I must admit that I picked up some absolutely wonderful friends amongst all these guys. And it's given me a focus to be able to overcome. You know, obviously, grief is a difficult emotion to deal with, but I've been able to. I would have been in a dark place had it not been for you guys. So I really am grateful for that. And I'm now starting to work out, like Paul saying about, I need to take a little bit of a backseat now so that I can come out with the new stuff, because I have done. I've come out with like Nie Rozumiem, which is Polish for I don't understand, and I'd start to come out with new tunes. And I've been to a couple of not EMOMs, like, again, Big Travels, Morphic Resonance and Awakenings. The way they do it, a guy called Peter comes across from Germany, and he couldn't make it across with all his equipment because of the import rules now. So when they got there, all the lads got together and lent him their bits and pieces, their Roland Boutique synthesizers, their filters, their bits of modulars. And the way he works on it, he starts at one side of the table, starts to set up a landscape. Next bit in the middle there starts to set up the filters, more variations, and then works his way around the table. And I thought, that's an interesting way of moving a set live. So I want to take a bit of a... I'll not stop doing EMOMs, obviously. I'm hooked. That bass, I can't get that bass anywhere else. But if I can go back to doing some live streams... and start to work through, admittedly in soft synths, I'm building up my studio again because I took it apart in order to take it on the road. Because like Jim, you know, we've got all this stuff in the door and no one else gets to hear it. And I thought, I've done some nice stuff. I'm sure someone else likes it. And it's lovely when I get, you know, surprise people saying, oh, I recognize you, mostly because of the daft hat and the crazy T-shirt.
I recognize you from 200 miles away. Yeah.
Yes. What do you got to do, you know, to get your stuff heard? So, yeah, so that I can go back to live streaming and rebuild the studio and then take version two out on the road with more new material.
Yeah. No. It definitely works really well, your stuff. I love listening to it, definitely. And it's funny, though, you mentioned about that fellow where he's sort of going around. I mean, in a way, Andy, that's your approach. You're building sort of the music over time. You know, it has to be physical. It has to be down to you to sort of do that. Now, I suppose for you, you know, you spend enough time, so you're building up the muscle memory to be able to do that, patching, you know, obviously some channels, some sounds will be already routed through, but there's still a lot of, like, you're just making it up as you go along, isn't there? Is that an intentional thing, or are you trying to get to another
absolutely.
Point?
Because I am unbelievably lazy. Now that might sound ironic, but I don't. The idea of sitting in front of a computer and writing tunes in whatever door and going through, like you've already mentioned, the option paralysis and all of that, and I know that it's going to become a necessary evil at some point, but I got no interest in it really, or very little. And actually, I haven't written a piece of music. As in sat down and intentionally written a piece of music for a long time. And I just don't do that. The improvisation and the making it up on the spot. I mean, that's even what Grace and I do when we're doing hardware jams. We'll have a basic idea. We'll have the theme for hardware jams to work to and things like that. and we might do a bit of pre-prepping. Oh, I've got this idea. And Grace has usually got some nice things going on by the time I get round anyway, and I just sort of tend to slot in. But not always. Sometimes it works differently. So, and as for, you know, as for the EMOM, it's basically been, until recently, it's been almost the same patch that's just been sort of reinventing itself and changing and developing. And I've added things in and altered it. And the same ideas have grown and developed. And then at Synth East, at the beginning of March, when I did the patch off thing with Robin Vincent, and I was very much trying to be modular clever. I was thinking, I don't know who I'm going to be drawn out with. These are guys who know modular synths inside out and backwards. I'm playing in front of an audience who will know modular synths. There's all the manufacturers. I need to do something which is, you know, interesting, modular, interesting, you know, clever. Well, it all just sounded bloody awful. It sounded pants. It was awful. And I'm getting closer and closer and closer to this date coming. I'm going, oh my God, it all just sounds rubbish. And I had to take a step back and go, you know, right, take stock. Andy, what do you know? What do you do well? What would your fallback position be? And go back to it. So yeah. There I was on Saturday morning of the actual event with the modulus in the hotel room, and I set it up in the hotel room, and I was patching it in the hotel. And eventually things started to happen, and it was from scratch. There were similar things. There were similar routings that I always have, like the 8-step sequencer going into the bearing and little synths and the various sound ideas. But I started getting somewhere and experimenting with something else. And then that patch that I started with at Synth East, that developed into what I did at Paul's Bash last week. Again, it was the same thing, but I took it a bit further with other things. So that's developing. And at some point over the next couple of weeks, well, sooner rather than later, I dare say, I'll record it. I'll actually do a performance in here of that patch. I'll have a look and refine it. In how things have developed, I mean, I started originally with a bearing a go case with a load of bearing and modules and some other bits in it. And as other modules have come in, I've added them, and they've given more flexibility. They've given the chance to give much more clearly defined sections to the music. I changed case. I went to actually a smaller case, but the one that's more portable. I've also then done a couple of EMOMs where I've used two cases, which was interesting and worked really well. But it's developing all the time. It is always a sort of work in progress. And what I'm trying to get to is something a little bit more like the way that Jim and Dave do, where they've got distinct and discrete tracks or songs within a set, because I don't have that at all. It's different sections and sounds that come in and out and give that structure within what I do. But I'd like to get more into that. I do have the wherewithal, and there is a couple of little modules which I've got now which will definitely help with that, but I'm still learning it. You know, in spite of having the brass neck to go on stage in front of a load of modular experts, I'm still a bit of a noob, really.
So, well, I think everybody's kind of thinks that about themselves when they start doing stuff. I mean, I've done a few EMOMs somewhere, but you know, I haven't sort of performed anything live I packed in gig in what 2006, yeah. And that was just like cheesy cabaret stuff anyway. So it's totally
different. You learn, don't you?
You do.
You learn quickly.
You do, yeah.
First time you did it, I bet you thought, oh, I'm not going to do it that way again. I'm going to do it like this. Or...
Yeah, yeah. Well, it was lucky because it was Homeforth and everything was in the dark, so. But before we go over to Paul and find out how you, we do have the fantastic Dots joining us. So, in case you don't know about Dots are very unique in that they were kind of like blues band. To a degree, but they also do a lot of like sort of live synth playing and more recently the whole sort of modular thing. So you've sent me something, haven't you? Where is it? Sure, I got it ready. Ah, yeah, it's a bit of mini modular moments with Dot, and here's a bit of Nikki.
Hello and welcome to another mini modular moment. If you watched the previous episode, you will have seen the epic fail that I experienced on stage with this modular. So now I'm going to investigate why that happened.
This is the offending patch from last night, and I'm going to double check what is going on here. I have not changed it since last night, so it should still sound awful. Okay.
So there's a bit of Nikki there from Dots, but you can see on my channel, just type in Dots, some of their performances that they do. It's very visual as well, which is great. And it's very unique and entertaining for it's quite refreshing sometimes, you know, because EMOM, some of the music can be a little bit hard, can't it? So, yeah. Thanks for joining, Dots. Yeah. Right, I think we better do a bit of news. There's not a whole lot going on in terms of new equipment. It is mainly actually in the sort of Eurorack land, but this one was really interesting. It's by Oxy Instruments and it's called Coral. I'll turn it off there because it goes a little bit awry in terms of the pitch, but it's quite an instrument, interesting little module, really. 14 HP, it's 8 full voices and multi-part, multi-engine, WAV player, and so on. It seems like a bit more of a Distin EX, so it's got multiple kind of functions, but it's more hands-on and certainly more visual. Price-wise, I have got it up somewhere. Let me just take a butcher's of that. It is $399 plus VAT. So it's not a cheap one, but it is something that you're going to, I would presume, keep in your case. Now, the best thing for me, really, is just to go over to Andy, really, because, you know, you're our expert on that whole modular world. So, yeah. Any thoughts on this? I mean, there seems to be quite a number of these polyphonic modules coming out now. Anything interesting about this one?
I was quite interested in the polycinematic. Was still am, to be honest. I think this takes that in a moves it up a whole level, and you get a much more sophisticated synthesizer for the money. I was really interested. You said in that demo where you said, "Oh, I think I better stop it at this point," because I got the giggles earlier, because, you know, you can create all sorts of amazing sounds, and then it goes into this bit that's bloody awful. Dots, I'm telling you think you had a nightmare. The guy that was doing that sound demo, he got it all out of tune and everything. It was proper wonky off.
It's different between discordant and out of tune, definitely. Yeah. It's terrible, that bit.
It was thinking, oh, God, they should have edited that bit out. That didn't work.
But, that's right. Yeah, you're
I think
right.
A lot of the sounds coming out of it really were really very, very interesting. You know, what will it be? £430 for a polyphonic synthesizer. Again, okay, because it's only a Diddy module. People are going, oh, well, you know. Yeah. But I think a lot of people will be up for it. At the minute, polyphony from me is served by the 1010 Bitbox micro sampler, which I got hooked up to the keyboard, so I can set that to be polyphonic if I need it to be. So at the minute, I'm not in that big a hurry to jump into that particular path.
No, it's just with you saying about you know, wanting to have more of a kind of track focus, you know, you've got set tracks rather than it being I mean, I suppose something with it being multi-part, it's something that you could
You
one part for one song, one part for another, all sections, and But I don't know. I mean, I suppose that could be the more that you work out those sections, is it possible that you could actually lose something along the way?
Well, that's always a danger, isn't it? When I was thinking about that, I mean, you know, if it's just, you know, it's nothing remarkable in lots of ways. It's a, you know, is it like sticking a D110 in your rack? You know, I mean, basically,
I've got one of those lying around somewhere.
Well, you probably have, yeah. I mean, that's the thing, isn't it? It's a multi-timbral mod. One of the things about modular is that it's a step away from intentional, you know, musical choices, and much more random and free form, seeing what happens, that level of improvisation, which of course can lead to chaos and results that a lot of people will say are unmusical.
Like,
so
that
for
demo.
Me, it's a bit like trying to find a halfway house between having a certain degree of chaos and a certain degree of control.
Yeah. Yeah. I find I have too much control because my focus has been on keyboards rather than the box, because I can't do the two at the same time. So I find I have to focus on that, but then it becomes more traditional backing tracks rather than anything else. But I would love to do what you and Jim do, really, but I don't know, my brain doesn't work at the moment like that. Anyway, we'll go on to you actually, Paul, because we didn't actually talk about sort of your music and how you've approached that and how it's changed, because obviously you had your lad on with you last time. So, a dog.
Well, you're gonna love this. Yeah, this is my little dog Jasmine. So. She's been running around, she's been laying around my feet all the time I've been talking, so I finally picked her up. When I went to do the first EMOM, which was at Derby for Jim, and on the Friday, as I was playing the following Thursday, I realised I'd actually got nothing prepared. Alison just said to me, just wing it. She says, I've heard you play for two and a half hours. She says, without repeating yourself, just improvising. She says, surely you can do 15 minutes. So I chucked
well
a sequence
said, Alison.
Down. I chucked a sequence down, put a few bits of drums to it, and improvised over the rest of it. Yeah. And it went down really well. In fact, that actually went better than some of the things where I've tried to improve it.
Yeah.
And it's gone wrong. Exhibit A, you do at Blackpool. I was ashamed of that. I haven't even...
But no one knew, because we didn't know your thing. That's the thing, you know. At least the power didn't cut out.
Yeah.
I was getting into it. I was getting all emotional with the chords, and then boom.
Yeah. All right. Yeah.
Well, we traced that a 50p.
We traced that to a broken lamp, which had been in storage for ages. When we got home, Martin unloaded his car and he left the lamps by accident by the side of the car because he was so tired. And when they got up next morning, they got up to two empty boxes. So with a bit of luck, somebody's been electrocuted.
Yeah.
that light was dangerous.
Looking over the landscape of Sheffield, puff of smoke. There they are.
Yeah.
Oh,
So
that's what those fire
engines. Over a period of time, I'm just evolving things, and then to cut a long story short, myself and Martin have known each other since we were about 17. I think I was about 18 or 19. He's a year or so younger than me, and I'd not seen him for 10 years till last year, and I got a message, and he'd had a stroke, and he'd had a brainstem stroke, so he was in a coma for 9 weeks.
Oh, wow.
I nearly died. And I started going to see him again. Because he's He's just got his license back as it happens. But I started going to see him every week, and I'd check him out. We'd go to go for a coffee locally, sort of thing. And when I told him I were doing these things, and he said, "Well, if you ever want any guitar doing," so stemming from that, Martin. That was the first time we'd played together, was at my birthday. And again, a lot of what he did was just on the spot, made up.
He was brilliant, definitely. I love that sound of that guitar. If you think of Prince's Purple Rain, that kind of chorusy, very nice kind of, you know, Fender.
It's kind of like... controlled but not. It was a great guitar sound, and it was just going into a Yamaha FX 770.
I was looking around for all the other things, and it was just this.
Pushing the buttons on the front, and that was
big Marshall stacks and all sorts over years. That thing is actually, he used to have that when I used to play with him 25 years ago. It's still the same processor. It's actually older than his son. You know, I think his son's 31 or 32. And it's still going strong. To be honest, he'd probably have difficulty finding something to do the same thing today because everybody's moved away from rack mounts.
Very true. You don't really see many sort of, especially new equipment anymore. Everything's all virtual, isn't it? Until they drop the licenses and make you go to subscription, which is a bit of a topic for us. Do you like that link there? That was really spot on, Jamie. Well done. Thank you, Jamie. It's a little bit done over the top. Everyone's been talking about it, and I didn't know whether to bring it up, really. But I do have some Waves things. I really only use Shep's Omnichannel now, which is like a multi-channel thing. It's got compression and... saturation, EQ, but it's in one plugin, and I always use it on synth sounds. It just sounds brilliant, you know. It just really sort of brings everything out, especially on subgroups as well. But I'm looking for a replacement because I've never particularly liked the fact that if you update it to the latest version, you lose access to it anyway, and you have to pay for, you know, pay like £200 to use one plugin again. And because you've updated, you can't use your old one, which was annoying. But then they dropped the thing of, right, forget about your licenses. You're going to have to go to subscription model. And then if you change your computer or whatever like that, then it's tough. Well, they have backtracked on that, which is very good. But I think it would have probably put off a number of people with that. Let me have a look. Yeah, Synth Anatomy kind of covered it. They're keeping the perpetual licenses and also the update plan, but still, out of all the ones, I mean, there's so many companies now, you just get free updates, don't you? You don't have to worry about it, and a lot of the time you get really extra features that are amazing. I mean, things like Omnisphere, I bought, it was even I think it was called Atmosphere back in the day. In fact, it was DV247 in Birmingham when they used to have like stores around the UK that I got it from. And ever since, it's been free updates. You paid your £299 or whatever it was at the beginning, and it's just been free for years. Whereas now, with this, I don't know. I'm looking, and of course, there's lots of other companies out there. Softube do really good stuff, and there's a whole host of...
I'm a big Softube fan, definitely. Yeah. What was funny actually was their homepage. If you look at that now, let me find it. It says spring sale, shop now, own forever. Invest in professional mixing tools and instruments that you get to keep. That's like a direct dig at Waves.
Yeah. I mean, it was a silly approach. And whoever thought, I mean, I didn't realize they were that big, you know, in terms of like the amount of people that were there. It's apparently like 300-400 people that were for Waves. I was hearing from somebody, whether it's true or not, I don't know. The internet and all that. I mean, do you any of you guys use their plugins? I mean, for a time they were the pinnacle, weren't they? Weren't they? There was the L1, you know, the sort of limiter and all that kind of thing. But some of them have been hogs. But so what are your thoughts then, Jim?
I mean, I don't use any. I've got some Waves plugins. I don't even know what I've got installed because they're not that great, really. I've got much better plugins by, like, say, the likes of SoftTube. They're much, much better. They are obviously not going to subscription model either. You know, they've pretty much laid that out now. I don't know. I've not. There's also an element with Waves. I don't think we might align politically, them being Israeli, and you know, I do have issues with, you know, the treatment of Palestinians and Gaza, and it's not likely that they're going to get any of my money going forward anyway. So,
I think it was a weird thing to do, and whoever thought it was a good idea in the company, I mean, there must have been somebody who said, "Hold on a minute, this is, you know." Fair enough, up subscription, because I've got Roland Cloud, and it's such great value for money now with what you get in there. I have to have it because of support, the sounds I've made for it, but still, it's what, $20, $19 a month, and you actually get to own some of the plugins as well. Mm. After
I do
a certain
like
amount.
My model. Yeah,
and some of their mod sounds, you know, you've got all the ACB stuff. Yeah, it's a bit of a hog on your computer, but the ACB stuff and then the ABM models and then their effects and everything, it's such great value for money. You know, they've kind of got it worked out right, and they were there at the sort of beginning, really, and there's the three different levels of subscription, so... strange. It's funny, actually, Ian J. Cole saying that Ozone might be doing, you know, Isotope might be going the similar sort of route, which would be a bit of a nightmare. I don't know. Andy, your thoughts on it?
I'd like to ask...
Oh, yeah. There you are.
I'd like to ask people if they've got things like Amazon Prime or Disney Channel or any of these other TV subscription services which are available, which the majority of people seem to be quite happy to pay for. They're quite happy to pay their 20 quid a month or whatever to have this service or that service, or, you know, they've got the Sky and they pay a bit more to get access to these other bits. And that sort of model in television's been around for ages, and if you get fed up of it, you can switch it off. I just think they made a real, really bad PR mistake.
Yeah.
Really.
Yeah.
That's all. They dropped a clanger, realised that they had, and backpedaled pretty smartish, and I suppose, you know. But somebody mentioned in the chat that it was, there may well be a lot of damage to trust. So, I also with software, I mean, my mind sort of gets a bit confused, you see, because they've got no post-development costs. Once they've made it and it's ready, there you go. They're not shipping out circuit boards and housings and keyboards and MIDI interfaces and all of that sort of thing, which you have on a piece of hardware, which costs
critical money. You do have to, you know, sort of maintain for new, you know, operating systems and frameworks and stuff.
Yes, indeed.
But
yeah,
it's not huge.
So, yeah, but they'll be selling lots and lots of things. My brain, I really struggle with the software thing. I always have done. I think my mind is really quite blown away by the fact that the software could cost you more than your actual computer. That's sort of always
confusing. Software developers are expensive.
Yeah, okay, but it's always been a strange thing that my brain struggles to compute.
Go back to the Atari ST.
Yeah, you've said. Well, exactly. You bought your Atari ST for $399. And then Cubase wanted 400. Anyway, and my head would go scratchy scratch, can't work that out.
And then you had to run the cratch version for it to be stable.
Yeah, there was that, wasn't there? Yeah, yeah, I do remember those. It's a bit of a strange one, though, I think, with this, because, you know, some of the... You're right, we do pay subscription for some things, we don't think about it. I think maybe with... I mean, like, if Isotope do it, I only do it every now and again, use their stuff. It's not like Netflix, I'll be watching it every single night or every other night. You know, there's use, but I suppose you just feel a little bit gutted when you don't, you think you own a license. You have the rights to use this license, but then all of a sudden, you know, it's sort of took away from you a little bit. But maybe
also, if you do write a tune with a particular plugin that's, you know, subscription plugin, then that project is then locked into you paying that money in order for you to access it from that point onwards.
Mm-hmm. That's true.
Otherwise, you're going to have to substitute it, and you may never get the same sort of sound again, especially if it's an instrument plugin or whatever. So it's kind of like, and how many companies are you going to be feasibly be able to do that with? You know, it's not the same as, you know, say Netflix and Amazon Prime, because you may just go, right, I'm going to cancel that one and just do Netflix for 2 months and then go back to Amazon for 2 months or whatever. But you can't do that if you're using, you know, plugins, unless you do that with all your plugins. Go, right, I'm just going to use Waves for the next 3 months, and then I'll switch over to UAD, you know. Speaking of, that is one subscription that does seem quite good value, actually, is the UAD, relatively.
Yeah, it used to be, actually, with, you've got all their plugins when you bought the hardware, didn't you? And then you could buy the extra. And then, yeah, they've gone over to that plan. Personas do that now as well, don't they? They've got, like, it because they have Studio One and then all the other sort of plugins, which I could never ever get to work on my machine. I think the thing is when you buy, you know, sort of package like Native Instruments, and maybe not so much Arturia because they're good value, but you buy it and then they'll add one or two new titles, one you might be interested in, but then you're paying for the updates again. And, you know, how many times do I have to buy complete? How many times do I have to buy, you know, that side of it? And then, of course, you can't really sell it, you know. So you're spending lots of money over the years. And
the best value bit of software ever has to be Logic Pro 10. Back bought it, however many, over 10 years.
It was
15 years? I don't know.
It was 8, I think. It was Pro 8 or Pro 9. I remember I bought it at the same sort of time as, because I used to be Cubase, and I went over from PC over to, because I was forever tweaking and twiddling with the PC and never getting anything done. So I thought, I'll go over to a Mac because I don't understand it. So I won't be able to do any of the twiddling and tweaking. So, and I've used sort of Logic ever since. But Dave, your kind of thoughts on Waves, if you've got any?
I can certainly appreciate that these companies are not charities. They need to earn money.
There's a commercial
And that, I think, is where they might be blinkered to that we're not all professionals. Some of us, you know, mention no names, are close to retirement. Others have retired. And the idea of spending, £25, £50 a month on software that you might not be sustainable. Now you've got all this free time and no money coming in. I mean, this also happens with small independent artists who might be between tasks. Suddenly find that £25 a month for Adobe, for example, they can't afford it. At the very time, they need to generate some revenue, get back in the game. I think that's the challenge of how to differentiate people who can afford it because they're professionals earning, you know, tens of thousands per project, and geeks like me with too many toys who just want to play and don't want to have to. I like to buy outright. Because then I know I've got it, but I know that time takes its toll on software as much as it does on hardware, and a time will come to replace it, but it'll be when I choose to, rather than, a deadline. Mm.
Yeah, well, the one that really does me, because I pay for Adobe Suite, and it's £51 a month. But I know that once I stop it, that's it. My software just doesn't work, and I've been paying that for 5 years now, or since they started the subscription. So, you know, I've paid a lot of money to them, and I don't own any of them. I've got to get my head scratched and get into some other software. But Paul,
DaVinci Resolve.
I've got Resolve, and I use that for converting and things like that. But there's certain things in Premiere are just really, really good and quick for me. Especially because I use my Stream Deck with it.
Oh yeah, yeah. I mean, I've that video I did for the Clown Fest. I mean, literally, I had no time, and I'm like, I want to do a multicam setup. So four cameras, you know, like I use two iPhones, an iPad, and a webcam. And it was an absolute piece of cake. So you just do the sound on all of them, and it syncs it all automatically. And then you just drag your multicam clip onto the timeline, and you can just use your numerical keys to switch cameras and edit it like in no time at all. It was an absolute piece of cake.
I that do was from it the hard way.
Not having used it in ages as well.
I do the hard way and go through every single shot. Anyway, Paul, your thoughts on waves and all that kind of thing. I mean, you've got like a little iPad that you use, but and I think it's Cubase, isn't it? You use
Cubase, I use. I've still got quite a bit of stuff for PC. I've still got Native Instruments, all that sort of gear. Over years, I've probably spent a fortune on soft synths. And it's same since I've had the iPad. I got the iPad, I put it on my phone account, so I pay for it monthly. So if I drop it, I can have a new one tomorrow. I've spent the average price of a piece of software for it, it's probably about 20 quid around that sort of price.
It's pretty amazing, isn't it?
Yeah. But I must have spent over £1,000 on software. There's 90-odd synthesizers in that thing already. Probably over 100 effects units. Basically, I think, and Dave's done the same. I don't like, I can see him smirking there in the dark, but Dave's done the same. We bought the iStore.
Smirking basically. In the dark. What a title for a song there, isn't it?
So I've got some Waves plugins. I don't think they're that special, to be honest. And for the last 3 or 4 months, I've not used the PC at all. In fact, it's just sat in the corner. Edward's got PC, and he's got quite a powerful one because he's playing games, etc. And he's got a couple of 32-inch monitors on it and things, so he can have one thing on one and one thing on another, and it drives me nuts. I mean, I had two 27-inch, and that was more than enough. So, but he's had two bigger ones still.
I remember when I went from first PC from a 14 to a 17, I thought I was in a cinema.
It's like myself and Dave both started with synthesizers. We built as first ones. We both built the same one. And we've been at it. I was 15 when I built mine. I'm 61. What's that? 46 years? So for 46 years, I've had some form of synthesizer. At some points, I've been totally software. Built up great sets of hardware, etc., and had to sell it because I was skint. Because I've worked for myself for quite a few years. You know, it's boom and bust, and it comes up to Christmas, and kids want Christmas presents, and you've got notes in your wallet, and you know your synthesizers, they go. You know, you can replace them. You know, I've done stupid things like I sold a Nord A1 for £450 plus a skin.
And it was less.
Didn't you sell a Model D Moog, didn't you?
Yeah, I had a Model D back in the day when it was something new and when all the digital stuff came out, nobody wanted them. And I thought, I'm getting rid of this. So I got rid of it. You know, what's it worth now? $4,000?
Yeah. Well, the new ones are like $5,300 something like that, which is bizarre. But I got into all of this in late 80s with the whole sort of house music thing, because I got into it through DJing and all that sort of stuff. So my first synth was the DX7 Mark II, which I had for 2 weeks and took it back.
No, come on, don't sit on the fence, Jamie. Tell us what you really
figure that thing out at all. and I actually exchanged it for a Roland D10, a brand new Roland D10, which I've still got. And it was because it was multi-timbral, and then with the Atari ST, that was it. I could do it. But my first thing was I actually when I was in the Midlands at the time, and all I had was a Casio RZ1 drum machine, an SK1 sampler, and my decks. So I worked my two tracks out between those and graph paper with 16 by 16 grid on a graph paper to work out all the. And I took that into a recording studio over in Birmingham and did my two tracks. It was £12 an hour, and I think each one was about 35 hours I did for these two tracks. I had no idea what it. Everything was sampled. I was just telling the guy what I wanted to do. I couldn't do it, but it was amazing. But that was the time when digital was sort of taking over and analog stuff was sort of, you know, everyone was selling it for peanuts to get their DX7. They were selling their Jupiter 8 to get a DX7. Yeah. You know what I mean? So anyway, speaking though, you got rid of the Model D. I'm going to go over and play this little video before then we start talking about artificial intelligence. Anyway, here's a bit of Moog with the Mavis Hive Mind 2. Let's check it out. About 20 grand on that table, isn't it? With Moog stuff, it's not cheap. But yes, you have got a subsequent 37 though, haven't you, Jim? Which did sound amazing, I must admit. It's one of their best, I'd say.
Yeah, I agree. It's there's something quite unique about it as well. Just the way it you know, it being duophonic and the sort of portamento between the oscillators and stuff, it's you can do some really special things with it.
Yeah, no, it's lovely. Yeah, I'm getting a few points, things people pointed out to me about the DX7 that Robbie won't like it. there's nothing wrong with the DX7. What it was me. That's what was wrong with it. It didn't work with my mind because it's my first ever synth. And what I had used in this studio, they had like a Moog Prodigy and an MC202. That's what I used for my acid. Got this DX because I tried it in the music shop, which was actually here in Blackpool. And I thought, oh, it sounded great. But then when you looked in the manual, and the guy actually told me a fib. He said, yeah, you could do like loads of different sounds at the same time. And it was a load of nonsense. It was just like taking advantage of a young, like 18-year-old. And And I took it and I just couldn't work out the thing. It was like, where's these knobs, these things I'm used to? So it went back.
You've kind of got to be Brian Eno to figure that stuff out. I mean, he makes coats.
It was. I mean, you know, no, not a problem. But back then, you know, whatever.
You've got to remember, Jamie, that a 303 has got to be better than a 101 because the numbers are bigger.
That was exactly it. I bought a 303 from, it was Sound on Sound, some of the ads in there. I bought a 303, cost me £100 because it had a load of battery acid mark on the back. And I got the 303 because I'd used the 202 in the studio. And I thought it was, because it was a higher number, it was a newer model. So I got it and opened it. I thought, what the hell is this piece of? You know, it's just this silver thing with this acid. And where's the display? Because I like the display.
Real acid.
The display was the 80s, and the 80s was the future. You know, and it was like, what's all this nonsense? And it sat in a box for 3 years. I couldn't figure it out. I sold it for £150. And to Martin from the Mobius, who was like big in the 90s with all rave stuff. Anyway, yes, interesting. That was a bit of the Moog thing. Now, going on to AI and the way that it's all sort of going with the whole thing. And I've actually got AI has got something to say, actually, now. So we'll have a look. Yes, artificial intelligence. And we've all been sort of got a little bit used to it. It's been a bit of a buzzword recently with artificial general. With the whole sort of let's find it, ChatGPT, which I've been using a little bit, and it's kind of blown my mind a little bit. It's not quite accurate. I asked it to do a bio for me for geosynths, and it ended up talking about geology. That geosynths
rock and roll.
is a team of geologists and geosynths, yeah, led by a passionate team of geology enthusiasts and music producers. So it kind of got that a little bit wrong about
it's stoned. That's what the AI is.
Oh, good one. But then something, of course, yesterday came out, and it was this, and I absolutely myself when I first saw it, because I thought, what I do for a living in sound design, and this came out.
That will render all existing synthesizers obsolete. Introducing SynthGPT, the world's first AI-driven text prompt-based sound engine. With the power of SynthGPT, you can now create any sound imaginable simply by typing a description. We developed SynthGPT by...
So is that, and it's actually done by Luffram, and Luffram's a brilliant sound designer. He does a lot with software, Diva and all that kind of thing, and he also has others who do sort of sound design. But I saw this and I thought, oh no, because I've been waiting for something like this to happen, where you just type in dark pad sound, you know, that's what you want, dark pad sound. I thought, oh, go on, generate the sound. And I thought it will probably be using it all by keywords, and then you know, it's generating it, and I thought, oh crap, I better it's ready now to play me sound. So, I mean, brilliant. Hats off to Luffram for doing that. I mean, it's got an amazing amount of views as well. But well, it was a slight relief. But it's only like a bit of a, because it will happen. I know it will happen. To a degree, you've got software now that will do, take one sound, another sound, and you can mix it together. In fact, there used to be an iPad app for that. I can't remember what it was called, but you could use your whatever synth that it supported. I think it did things like the Moog Voyager and a few other things. And you could pick that sound, that sound, that sound, and blend between Morph, I think it was called. But it will get to a point. Now, you see a lot of synths where software synths, and it's a lot tagged with different names and things. And my only concern is, obviously, with what I do for a living, is sound design, is that, you know, someone's going to, do you know, like in Logic Pro, you've got all these drummers. You can pick Dave or Fred or whatever like that. And they're different styles of drummers. You can somehow, someone will get my sounds, download them, and create a model, a virtual model of me. And they just make pads like Jamie. Geosynth pad mixed with a blend of some other sound designer, and but that's you know, kind of, it's all a bit of a kind of scary moments, and I know that you've got the likes of Elon Musk saying that we should put a bit of a pause on this now. I don't know, AI, is it going to be a good thing? Is it? It does seem to be, though. On a serious note, where we thought it would be things like, you know, sort of accountants and all that sort of stuff, it's actually, it's carving away at the creative people. You know, we've seen what AI can do with sort of, imagery and photography and all that sort of stuff. I suppose maybe, yeah, you can, you know, technology come. Go on, you go for it.
Yes, in my opinion, it's the wrong application of it. You know, this stuff should be freeing up our work time so we can do more creative things, not this sort of freeing up the creative things so we can do more work.
So you just want more time to stroke that cat of yours, then? Is that what it is?
No, I quite like it.
Blofeld moment. I mean, what's going on here? Is this like supporting the PCA?
We look like a pair of Bond villains.
Yeah, look at you.
Yeah, I quite like it. There was Alice from Mercurial Tones did a piece on it, and I think she made a very valid point that it's just another tool. For example, I describe samples and sample loops as absent members of the band. So here you have here a somewhat challenging extra member of your band now who can do all sorts of things, but you still have to tell the stupid thing what to do. Yeah. For example, but you can turn it off if it doesn't get out of control. But for example, like if you put Jim's setup in front of me with the subsequent 37, people were saying, oh, I must buy one of those now. Hang on a minute. Jim is priceless. I wouldn't be able to do with that equipment, that exact same stuff, what Jim can. Same with Andy's stuff. He's got this wonderful modular here. And I give me the exact same tools and I'd create something completely different. And I think it's the same with ASI, with AI. We will all do different things with it.
I don't think I'd get a sound out of Andy's kit, to be honest. It'd take me about 3 hours to get
the buzz from the line out.
Where's that main sound coming from?
I talk about artificial intelligence. It was actually real stupidity the first time I actually explored modular.
Yeah.
It was, you know, there was no artificial. It was actually real, and it was very, very stupid. And I was trying to connect two very basic things. I was trying to connect a Model D to a 960 sequencer. I was thinking, I understand synths. I understand sequencers. It took an no. It's all to do with the labeling on the bloody box.
Oh, right.
Right. Okay. Because I'm not going to go into it now, but honestly, it took me an hour and a half and I was really thinking, what have I done? What have I done? This is ridiculous. You know, I've spent all this money and I can't even make it go. You know, it was anyway. Oh, the artificial intelligence thing is just so bloody weird from our point of view. One of the things I liked about electronic music was that slightly dehumanized element of it. I loved that. And of course, it was slightly robotic, the otherworldliness, the sci-fi-ness.
Yeah.
And yet, as the sci-fi now begins to become reality, I actually find it really quite scary. I just think Skynet is around the corner, if it doesn't exist already. And I think, you know, I tend to take a rather bit of a doomsday sort of approach to it. I think as soon as you get machines to think,
Well, it's once it goes more sort of, because it's general intelligence, isn't it? I mean, you can have specific things, specific tools, but it's the general intelligence which is, I see this now at the moment a bit like when computers first started to come out. They could do, you know, a bit of accounts and stuff. They weren't, you know, they weren't in everyone's home or anything like that. It was.
It's now very rapid data analysis more than anything else, isn't it? It's data analysis. Yeah. Analyze equals that. And that's what they give you. So it's not really thinking. But
The thing is as well, I mean, in terms of the legal argument, it's like there is data being used for this, like people's creativity.
Hmm.
It's actually being used to sort of feed these algorithms. It's kind of like no royalty is being paid for the use of that data, you know. And
no, you're right.
Should be.
Because
you know, this is like
use of intellectual property.
Yeah, exactly. You know, even though it may not be contained in the actual output, like say with sampling something, it's still being used to train algorithms in order to imitate. So it's kind of like, at some point, it is essentially like taking a sample and mangling it to the point where it's not recognized anymore. But that was the starting point. Mm. So it's kind of like, yeah.
But it's like Movement 81's point out. Imagine being a visual artist at the moment, because that seems where it's changing a lot. And to do, of course, with these like NFTs, and which were a bit of a buzz, you know, taking, you know, a well-known artist's image painting and then somebody else and then creating a combination of it. It's not 100% perfect, because I've seen some images of where they generate like, you know, a model or whatever like that, and she's got a third arm or something, which is a bit strange. It reminds me a little bit too much of what was that Arnold Schwarzenegger movie where it was in Mars?
Total Recall. Yes. Total Recall. We better not talk about that.
No, we won't. But you know what I mean. It's the third arm, and so it's not quite there yet, but it's
great for comedic value, though. Some of the things that people have come out with is just like hilarious. So I think as long as it's for fun, then they were all right.
Yeah. I mean, though, seriously, though, I did try this. The first thing I ever tried, and I never stored it, I was asking it about Deep House and the jazz chords, you know, just as a test. And it read out a load of chords, like C minor, A flat, and all that, did that. And then I then typed in, make a MIDI file of it. And it did it. Mm. But when I went to click it, it said, no, we don't do blah, 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 blah. This is just a language thing. Mm. But what it did do is I said, here, make a Deep House chord progression MIDI file. And it says, you can't do that. But it then created the notation in kind of code. So there is an element of...
Well, someone built a plugin, a VST plugin of an Ibanez Tube Screamer just from GPT chat.
Yeah.
And giving it as a set of instructions. Yes, admittedly, it needed tweaking afterwards, but it spat out all the source code for it.
Oh, yeah. Well, that's the thing. It
VST,
is.
Yeah.
Because it is a language sort of tool. And I know some people have been building sort of apps as the interface to sort of GPT. I mean, like I say, we're really only at 2 weeks, says Wagyu. Very good. We're only at the beginning of this, but I'm a little bit sort of concerned. Yes, there is the element of Skynet, and I'll be back, and it's all sort of game over. Though I think our mate Vlad over that side has got that kind of sewn up to a degree. Not really, mate. Maybe it is a absolute threat to us all, or maybe, you know, we'll just grow with it like we've grown with lots of other things. I mean, social media has been such a positive thing for us. you're all old enough, like, you remember time before the internet, don't you? You do remember our things. We're slightly different than they are now.
I can still talk
when you had to walk to phone box.
Yeah, you want to walk to the phone box.
Phone box. You haven't got a phone at home. I want a mobile.
Pips. Yeah. Anyway, who knows how things will sort of advance? I don't know. I don't know with all this. That was a bit of a wild one, wasn't it? I think. Yeah, there are some other things. I do want to mention actually this, because I think it's really good. Chomp. They've actually met and absolutely blown past their goal. It was £24,000 their goal, and they're going up to £1 million. So just to remind some people of how it sounds, here's a bit of Chomp.
It's kind of like a granular delay reverb all in one knob. When you click the encoder, though, you have access to other effects, and these effects stack on one another.
So it's got effects. I can see multiple people like an EMOM using one of these. You know, like an orchestra, a chomp orchestra. But they've got the Kickstarter's been and I think they'll start going out at the end of the year, and it's around what is it, $499. So around £405, but obviously you'll have all taxes and import and all that kind of thing. I mean, it's fascinating that they've done that, and it's really, really good. And I remember when I first heard it, I thought, that sounds great. Not 100% sure on the, you know, because you could see, actually, your whole sort of family getting involved with it. It's got that kind of look about it. But the knobs and everything, the buttons on there are very chunky, like an old 1970s computer. So, don't know. Anyone going to get a Chomp? And I don't mean the little 25p suite that you get.
That pulls your fillings out.
Yeah.
No, I mean,
any thoughts on Chomp?
It looks fun. It's fun. An expensive bit of fun in a way, I think. I mean, it's the immediacy of it is really appealing. You know, the fact you can just literally just bang sample something, a bit like the old sort of Casio SK1s and stuff like that.
Yeah.
I mentioned before, you know, so it's really fun like that. It's one of those things. There's the immediacy is traded off with, you know, its limitations.
Of course, yeah.
I mean, if money was no object, I would pick one up. But money is an object, and I don't think I will. Yeah,
I can definitely see someone like Ian, because he used that organelle thing or whatever it's called. I could see him, because it's sounding great with all the granular and everything going on there. It's amazing how that's sort of going on. But then again, we were talking about AI, so maybe it'll be like a Bluetooth link from your head to that, and it'll be controlling you. Twitching and everything, so who knows what kind of happened. I think that's pretty much come to the end of it, really. I don't think there's much more really to go over, so just go around, everyone say what you're going to be doing, what's coming up, and any sort of plans, any new bits of gear you're going to buy. We'll do that. Andy, anything from you?
Just a premiere at Up Us 9 tonight, which is the performance from Synth East. Robin Vincent sent the stems and things, so Grace was very kindly sort of edited it together and worked some of her magic and sprinkled some fairy dust on the audio just to bring it up a little bit. It's already been out on Robin's channel for a few weeks, so it's not really a premiere, but it's now up on mine, and we'll be going out at 9:30. Tonight, and then other than that,
there's the link.
Thank you very much. Not a right lot. This I keep saying Thursday because EMOM is Thursday is EMOM day, but it's not, it's Friday. So, Friday, EMOM at Sheffield, either playing or not, I don't know. So, if I'm not playing, I'll be there as a punter to support all the other guys who are down there. Are you playing at it, Paul? Are you playing at this one?
I'm just thinking to myself here, I might decide not to play, so you'll be able to have my slot, Andy, and I'll be there to watch.
I'm not looking for spot. If you want to play, you play, but if you do, just let Brawny know. And say, give it to Brooksy.
I don't know whether I'll be playing it on my own or I'll be playing it with Martin.
Do it with Martin.
Martin was on about playing it. But I've ended up with the 12th slot, which is, I figure, is about 10:15. What was that like? That, for him, I think, will be a bit late. So it's I'm seeing him on Tuesday. We'll take it from there. Or I might play it on my own. Or as I say, I may not play it at all, but I'm coming down anyway. There's a lot of guys on like yourselves.
The Sheffield ones is a good event, full stop. So
it's a good night. Good night. It's quite difficult to get on there as well. I'm surprised that I've actually managed to get on two EMOMs running. Then the week after that,
you got some secrets on Ronnie or something.
I don't know, but I did give him a lift down to Derby and back last EMOM.
Ah, right. So there it is.
And of course, I'm playing Derby.
You're doing
20th, yeah.
Right. So Jim, you tell.
Yeah, so I'm doing an hour set at the Sheffield EMOM on Friday, Good Friday. I think I'm on at 11 PM. I'm not sure if we sorted out the running order, but it should be really good. There's extra visuals and lights and stuff going to be there for that. So that's going to be really good. Andy, I was going to ask you actually, how long's your premiere on for tonight?
About 12 minutes.
Right, cool. Because I've got my Clown Fest set that's not public yet, and I might do it after yours.
It's about 12:30. I'm not entirely sure. You'd think I'd know, wouldn't you? So it's about 12-13 minutes. So it's not a huge. If you put it on at 9:45, it will definitely be done.
Yeah. It might go as an instant premiere. I'm not that averse with YouTube and stuff because a minute's unlisted, and I'm not sure if I can then actually set a time for it or just set it
can.
To instantly
yeah,
premiere.
You can. This clown can do it, so you can.
Right, okay.
It should be the same link, actually, so I'll paste in there.
Cool.
Dave, what about you? What's coming up for you?
Well, next on Sunday, I've got the Leeds EMOM. That's an unusual day for an EMOM. So Joe Kemp managed to get the afternoons. That's great, because then I don't have to beat through rush hour traffic to reach.
Where's it at, the Leeds one?
Wharf Chambers now. So it's a wonderful venue.
Pub, wasn't it?
That was great. But it's now moved to Wharf Chambers. And I like that because when the bass bins kick off, the whole stage bounces. It's like, yeah, it's fantastic. I've got technical support for Bleep, which I just turn up with a bag of wires because there's always somebody that might not be able to connect. So I'm looking forward to that. And then there's the Beats.
I'm playing Bleep as well.
Oh, looking forward to that. It's not an EMOM, but it's an electronic music party. So it does cater for the homebrew electronic people who do stuff at home. And it gives people a platform like EMOM, but it's curated because we know we're catering to the members of the public. So we want to put on a good show. So it's great that it's a friend of an EMO if you want to think of that way. And then we've got then Beats Tea, which is again on a Sunday. Amy Valentine trying to set up a true EMO for Manchester. Again, we need to find a venue, so we're looking forward to that. More things going on all the time. Even though I'm trying to slow down so that I can compose some new stuff. Build my studio, fill my flight case so that I can do the jack-in-the-box trick that you guys could do so well.
It's not that easy.
I know, you do make it look easy. You'll probably have a nightmare when you get home. I've seen you after a gig just doing all the cabling. But that's the time to do it, not when you're at the venue and you want to perhaps talk to people. Because it's the society, it's the community that's the important bit for me as well, you know.
Yeah, no, it's like when I ran the EMOMs here, it'd all be nice and neat when I went, but when I took it and broke it all down and went back, it was like a human-sized ball of wool. Everything was all just interlinked. And, you know, how it happens, I don't know. That's the thing. We're in this age of AI, but we still haven't used cables. Anyway, there it is. But, all right, guys, well, thank you very much for joining me. And those of you in the chat room as well, thank you very much for sticking with me. I won't be doing a show next week because it is Easter and I'm actually having a day off, which I think the last day off was Christmas. Right. So that's the downside, isn't it, Paul, working for yourself? You never get a bloody day off. So, I'll be working.
I'm retired.
Yeah, yeah. I think, I might actually be working on the Prophet X, but I'm also doing a video with the LFE because I've actually got a nice new one now. Steve Hunt from Yorick Tech came over and I got a nice one that's starred in the OBX8. So, and he's done some new feature. I said, oh, can you do this? And can you do that? And oh, I don't know if I can do that. And then 2 days later, he's designed it. So he's built me a nice, lovely...
Is that the same Steve Hunt who was in the chat earlier?
It is. Yes. Yes. Oh, cool. He popped over a couple of weeks ago. And I asked him to, you know, with things like the sort of the sequential things like Prophet 5s and OBX, if you use like a bit of vibrato from the LFO, that's your mod wheel. You can't use it for anything else because if you use it too much, it'll go woo, woo, you know, as it does. So he's actually come up with a way of creating a matrix, you know, like you'll have like a mod matrix in some sense. But that externally, so then I can use controls and all that kind of stuff. So yeah, that's what I'll be experimenting a little bit with, and a few other things. So, everyone, thank you very much. Like I say, no show next week, but I'll be back the following one, and it'll be the EMOM Monthly with Martin, Christy, and two or three extra guests. So, yeah, that'll be that. Right, thanks very much, guys, and I will leave you now with a little bit more of James Glew on the Clownfest set. We'll move on a little bit, and I shall... Oh, there's that lovely subsequent 37. Yeah. And a lovely picture of Dom there as well. See you next week. No, we won't. See you the week after.